Hi, everyone. Welcome to California Rebel Base, the show where we try and figure out what is going wrong with California and how to put it right. We have a fantastic guest today, and we're going to devote the whole show to talking to him because he's just got so many great perspectives on so many of the issues that affect us here in California. I've been a huge fan of his on a number of different topics. I've had him on my Fox News show where we talked about nuclear power, where he's really changed my perspective on that. But today we're going to be talking about homelessness. The guest is Michael Shellenberger. He's the best-selling author of Apocalypse Never and the author of the upcoming book with the fantastic title, which I can't wait to talk about on another occasion nearer the publication date, San Fransicko, Why Progressives Ruin Cities. Michael, great to see you. That book, what a brilliant name. And I can't wait to hear all about it. And I'm imagining that homelessness is going to be part of that story.
Yeah, it's a book that I've been working on for a couple of years. It's a topic that I was really passionate about. I'm very concerned about the addiction and overdose crisis that we're in as a whole country, but it's particularly acute in California, particularly in the Bay Area, and the different dimensions of that, including the serious mental illness that often underlies street addiction.
Yeah.
But I also take a broader look at questions of criminal justice, policing, and then trying to get at sort of what are the underlying drivers of these policies that have really allowed both the drug and untreated mental illness crises to spiral out of control.
Yeah, well, that's totally relevant to the conversation I want to have with you today about homelessness. And in fact, the thing that really prompted me to want to talk to you about it was a really detailed thread I saw from you on Twitter just the other day, where you laid out some of these connections, and you did it in such a precise way, and also ended with I always love, which is actual concrete solutions and recommendations from a policy perspective, rather than just complaining about what's gone wrong. So, just because we got a bit of time now, I'd love you just to lay out in more detail the argument you made in that thread, and starting with this question we always ask when we talk about homelessness, like why is it so bad? Why does it seem to have gotten so out of control in California, in the big cities, especially considering how much money has been spent and is allocated by politicians at the state and local level to deal with homelessness, to solve the homelessness crisis, and it never seems to work?
Yeah, that's right. What we call the homeless crisis is really an untreated addiction and mental illness crisis. The governor has just proposed spending an additional $12 billion of our $100 billion surplus or so on the issue. But it looks like what he'll do is going to make the problem worse. In fact, that's what policies supposedly addressing this issue have done over the last 30 years. To give you some context of it, I was partly inspired to write this book because I was in the Netherlands giving a talk on energy at Delft University. And my sponsor, the person that brought me out, was a member of parliament. Her husband is a sort of a high ranking guy now in terms of drug policy in the Dutch government. And we were just chatting and I was like, have you ever been to San Francisco? And they come to San Francisco. He's like, I've been to San Francisco. I've done rounds there with at the emergency rooms, and I've seen the situation. And I was like, what's going on? I mean, the Netherlands is this really progressive country. It has basically decriminalized marijuana. It has decriminalized prostitution. It's experimenting with psychedelic drugs. Nobody would argue that the Netherlands is a conservative country, and yet they don't have thousands of people living on the streets and dying from drug overdoses using the hardest drugs known to humans. And so I asked him, I was like, what is it you guys are doing? And that was really what kind of got me started on this journey, was understanding what you have to do to address this problem. And it's basically the opposite of what progressive Democrats, something, an identity I used to hold myself for a very long time until writing this book, actually, that it was basically the opposite of what progressive Democrats are doing in California and other parts of the world. And I thought that was a really interesting story because it gets at, you said how, and you asked, is the book How Progressives Ruin Cities? I do describe how progressives ruin cities, but I wanted to go one step further too and ask, why are they doing that? Why are we doing that? Why have we done that? What is the underlying these policies?
Really interesting. That's just on the homelessness question. I want to sort of set it up this way, which is when you hear the conversation now about homelessness, and it's such a big issue. A poll just recently, for example, in the Bay Area, it was the number one issue for everyone, the number one political issue. The conversation, it seems to me, like goes immediately. Well, first of all, it includes what you've said. When people, you know, so smart people, well-intentioned people talk about homelessness, they definitely mention mental health and drugs and addiction for sure. But I think an accurate description of the current conversation would be to say that it really, the number one thing that's always mentioned is affordable housing. That's what always comes in the foreground. The reason we have this homelessness crisis is because we have not enough affordable housing, and that's why that's the sort of main solution. You didn't start there. You went straight to the point about the untreated mental health and addiction crisis. What justify that? Why it's that rather than the affordable housing point that we should really be focusing on?
Sure. And I should say too, for your listeners, this is really a California problem. So the number of homeless, both people living in shelters and unsheltered, those are the two kind of categories of homeless people. The number of homeless outside of California declined 18% between 2000 and 2020. It increased 31% in California. So literally when
just to be clear, between 2000 and 2020, went up in California, but down by 18% in the rest of the country.
You got it. Went up 31%. So this is not an illusion. If you've been living in California for 10 years and you've noticed how the homeless problem got a lot worse, it's not an illusion. And by the way, it remains the number one issue in the state. I mean, after COVID, obviously, but it remains, when you ask voters, their number one concern, it is homelessness. Mm-hmm. So you're right. I mean, look, the word homelessness itself is a propaganda word. And that's not even my opinion. Like, in fact, very progressive scholars and others have documented how this word homeless was invented in the 1980s, deliberately, I think, to mislead people. I mean, one of the people I quote calls it a fluffy word that was invented to increase sympathy for the people on the street. You know, before that, we called people hobos, tramps, transients, and worse names than that. So homelessness is really a propaganda word. The problem with it is that it completely misidentifies the cause of people being on the street. If you are priced out or evicted and you don't have a drug problem or mental illness, you don't go and camp in the Tenderloin neighborhood of San Francisco or in Skid Row of Los Angeles. You just don't do that. You end up in a tent living on the street because your addiction, often on top of a mental illness, not always, has driven you to those circumstances. You've probably been kicked out of your parents' house or your partner's house, or you've been couch surfing and your friends got sick of you taking their money or stealing their drugs or whatever, and you end up on the street. So we're dealing with severe drug addiction crisis. Just give you a sense of it. In the year 2000, 17,000 people died of drug overdose deaths in the United States. Last year, it's going to be nearly 90,000. That is just a shocking increase. That's a 73,000 person death increase annually. 52,000 people die. Americans died in the Vietnam War over a decade and a half. So you're talking about just a bloodletting. I mean, I it's hard to, you know. So I mean, I've worked on climate change. To give you a sense of it, 450 people die of natural disasters in the United States. It's just not
right.
Like, nobody gets killed by natural disasters anymore. But this unnatural disaster, this human created disaster, is killing almost 90,000 of our brothers and sisters and our loved ones and our siblings and our fellow human beings in the most barbaric ways, living in degrading circumstances. There's no ethical tradition in the world that sees what's happening on California streets as anything other than totally immoral and something that should be halted immediately.
Yeah. Can I just...
Sorry, I've digressed a bit.
No. I mean, I agree with you completely about the, you know, barbarity. I just want to sort of press you a bit on the housing point, because, you know, I'm totally sympathetic to your argument, but I want to be fair to all sides of the argument, for example, where, you know, for, this is anecdotal. One thing is anecdotal, and another is there is some data behind it. One anecdotal thing, which was presented to me as a kind of, you know, resident of the Bay Area on our local NPR station when they did a focus on homelessness, I was really struck by some of the personal stories they told about people who were living on the streets. That's the unsheltered group, right? You have sheltered and unsheltered homeless. So these are unsheltered people living on the streets. And a couple of the stories stuck in my mind. Both of them were related to people who lost their jobs, lost their regular income, and therefore couldn't afford their regular housing. One was a mother, I think, of three children who lost her job, couldn't make rent, ended up living in the car in a parking lot because she couldn't afford rent. And that was one example. Another was an older guy who I think I remember it precisely was an engineer at Oracle, a professional person, worked at Oracle as an engineer, lost his job, couldn't find another because he's a little bit old, couldn't get back into the tech industry where he had worked, had a few kind of random low paid jobs, bars and whatever. And then they dried up. And then he ended up living with his son, I can't remember, one of his children, who was, and they were just on the, about to get married, lived in the spare room. The fiance or the new spouse didn't want the father around. So they kicked him out. And so he ended up sleeping rough under a freeway. Both of those stories, and basically all of the presentation of the issue was through stories like that. Both of those were precisely to do with, neither had a drug addiction problem. Then the final point I'd make.
Are you sure about that?
Well, I'm just telling you what I heard, right?
It's interesting. I mean, I find in a lot of these stories,
I want you to respond to this, which is I went to which I found, you know, really informative event put on by Arnold Schwarzenegger's foundation at down in Los Angeles about a year ago, I think, just before the pandemic shut everything down. And one of the things they had someone presenting data on homelessness. And one of the things that I really remembered was, again, it was presented through a kind of survey of the homeless population in LA, which was, it was something like this: 25% of those who are sleeping on the streets, unsheltered, when at the moment they do that, do not have a mental health problem. With those who are there by a year later, 75% do. In other words, the argument there was people who become homeless, it's not the mental health that's making it; they actually develop mental health problems by being homeless. So just respond to all of that.
Okay. Let's pull some stuff apart first. So the first thing, the most important thing in some ways, is just that we should not be mixing up people who are very poor and need some help to be able to pay their rent, who are very poor but functioning well. They're not suffering from mental illness. They're not suffering from drug addiction. They just need some help to kind of get on with their lives, find a job, have stable housing. We should not mix those people up with people who have serious mental illness and or drug addiction. That's just the first thing. Like, you would never do that analytically, academically. You shouldn't do it because you would be doing different things for different populations that are totally different. So, you know, and there's some of it that's the first thing. The second thing is there's a lot of this that I just don't buy it. I mean, if my dad, like if we lived in a small house and my dad and we didn't have, enough room for my dad or my son, they would sleep on the floor. They would not be sleeping under a highway. I mean, think about that for a minute. So when you read the cases, and I've read many, many cases, you interview many, many people, and the guy's sleeping under the bridge. I do not come across a lot of cases. I haven't come across, honestly, any case where anybody is sleeping under the bridge without a serious addiction problem or a serious mental illness or both. Right. This is not during the Great Depression, we actually had really poor people from Oklahoma and elsewhere coming to California sleeping in tents who were just poor. But that was 100 years ago. I mean, we're in the throes of a massive addiction epidemic. Okay, just you can see it by the numbers itself. So I find that the journalists, to some extent, have participated in this. It's getting a little bit better, I think, in part because the addiction is so obvious now. But they have in the past, in an effort to do like activists and make homeless people more sympathetic, have not revealed the addiction problem in the cases that they're describing. And I think that's really misleading and really dishonest. And it's, but it's fundamentally, in other words, we actually have pretty good solutions for the mom with three kids who needs to escape an abusive father. You know, we actually cities have pretty good solutions for them. And when you interview the social workers who work with the homeless, the first thing they'll tell you is that's the easiest population to deal with. Like all they need is like an apartment. But if you are in the throes of a serious addiction or mental health crisis, you don't just need an apartment. And in fact, what we now know is that a lot of those folks end up suffering from drug overdose deaths because they are alone in their apartment and they overdose from fentanyl.
If so, that's the wrong solution. That's the wrong, exactly the wrong solution for them. It's not a solution for them.
It should be contingency based. In other words,
let's get to that.
Housing should be a reward. Yeah.
Do you have any sense of the? I mean, just that you've studied it, you've read the story. Any sense of the proportion? What are the numbers, by the way? Let's just remind actual numbers in California now. Just the latest data. Is it? I can't remember how many are we talking about people, literally unsheltered, living on the streets.
So there's 161,000 people that have been counted homeless in total, sheltered and unsheltered. Of that 161,000, 116,000, I believe. I should check those numbers, make sure they're exact, but it's about right. 116,000 are unsheltered. In the city of Los Angeles, there's about 40,000. And in the broader metropolitan area of Los Angeles, it's 60,000. In San Francisco, it's around 8,000 total and 4,000 or 5,000 unsheltered. And there's various, it's very, very hard to get a good estimate of how many people, either sheltered or unsheltered, are suffering mental illness and addiction. It's not something that people like telling to strangers with clipboards coming up and asking them, hey, are you using illegal drugs? You can see why a lot of people would not want to answer that question honestly. Nonetheless, The basic estimates are that about 4,000 people in San Francisco are suffering both mental illness and drug addiction and are homeless.
That's half and of the number.
Half. And in Los Angeles, the best analysis shows that 2/3 have either mental illness or drug addiction. But when you interview the social workers, you know, it's and this is anecdotal, but when you interview the social workers that work in the open air drug scenes, which is the right word to describe the open air drug markets of Tenderloin, Skid Row, or The Blade in Seattle, they'll just tell you, they're like, there's nobody here that's not addicted to drugs. Like, there's nobody in these tents that's not using, you know, usually meth or an opioid. Increasingly, both meth and fentanyl are being used by the same people. And it's just, these are astonishingly dangerous, hard, and addictive drugs. And when you interview, you know, I interview very progressive people, people who are very, very far to the left. And they, and the people that are close to the homeless, you know, the researchers and the social workers, and they'll just tell you, they're like, this is the main event. It's not like being homeless is about all these other things. You know, it's about, you know, and some people, sure, some people make money in some ways, but a lot of it's about theft and a lot of it's about, you know, but basically it's about serving these addictions that people don't have control over. And to sort of describe it. So here's what I would say about housing. Expensive housing is not the cause of what we call homelessness, which is the street addictive homelessness. But it is, we need more housing in order to solve it. And so, and the problem is that we have been giving housing to people without conditions. That's not how they do it in the Netherlands. Housing is a reward for getting clean off of drugs or for taking your psychiatric meds or both, since they often go together, or for doing other things like going to work. So when I was in the Netherlands shadowing the social worker, this person, the same guy, when he was interacting with people on the street or people in shelters, actually, he would offer people their own room, which everybody wants. They want their own apartment. They want their own studio apartment, right? Everybody wants that. But they couldn't get it unless they did what they needed to do as part of their personalized plans. And their personalized plans included not taking hard drugs, taking their psychiatric medicines, going to work. And by the way, they don't care about marijuana. You know, like one of the women that we were interacting with went out and smoked a joint. And I was kind of like, that doesn't worry you. And they were like, marijuana? Like, we don't want her to use heroin. But I mean, so in other words, they're very clear about what it is that matters and what helps people to get on the right path. And we're
not. Let's start by when we sort of think about the right route. First of all, I just want to have massive agreement with you. Affordable housing and housing generally is a massive issue that we need to address in its own right. You know, it's just not okay that people have to live, you know, so far out, you know, who work, I don't know, in the Bay Area, have to live a 2 or 3 hour commute away. You know, that's just horrible for their life. They don't get to spend time with their family if they're spending, you know, a total of 5 hours getting to work in a normal, you know, pre-pandemic and we hope post-pandemic. So that's a big issue in its own right. It's not like we're saying, oh, who cares about affordable housing? We really care about it, but just because it's a big issue in its own right. Let's now come back to homeless. So first of all, could you just talk a little bit about the policies you've seen implemented here in California or the approach that's wrong, you know, that's making it worse? What are the specific things you're seeing that make it worse?
I mean, just to summarize it, the single thing that you can find it in many different aspects of it, but it's just carrots only.
Okay.
In the Netherlands, Rene, when I said, why are we so messed up? He kind of goes, because he knew exactly what I was talking about. I was like, why do we have so many people on the street? And he goes, look, you always have to have a carrot and a stick, always. And that sounds harsh to us in California because we're so liberal. Oh my gosh, a carrot. I mean, a stick. Oh no. That's how you have to do it with addiction. Addicts are not in control. They need some help to gain some structure. And so it means that like you go to shelter, here's how it should work. You have to sleep in the shelter. You don't get to sleep anywhere you want in a civilized society. You sleep in a shelter and you get yourself a cot and you get yourself a basic bed. Would you like to have your own studio apartment? That is a possibility. We might offer you that, but you would have to become free from drugs. Otherwise, you're not going to be able to do anything.
So what underlying this is an assumption that we have a kind of service provision where you have an individual worker from, and I'd like to understand how the current provision is structured. Is it a government social worker? Is it a local nonprofit? You know, but what you're talking about is that we do have people who are going out and interacting with the people on the sleeping on the streets and trying to help them. It's not a lack of provision. Is that correct? It's just that they're doing the wrong thing.
Yeah, absolutely. So, I mean, the big policy is this thing called Housing First, which is the same thing as harm reduction. And the idea is, every single person that's homeless should get their own studio apartment. And so the consequence, and they say, we don't want to build any more homeless shelters.
Saying this? Where's this coming from? Is it the state?
This is the consensus among every level of government, including the federal government for the last 20 years.
Right. Housing First.
Harm reduction. Yeah, they just get their own studio apartment. Well, obviously, that's not been possible. We haven't been able to build that many apartments. And moreover, it doesn't work because it doesn't actually deal with the cause of the problem, which is the addiction. The Dutch do it totally. And I say the Dutch, by the way, it's every major developed nation that solved this. It's Japan. You know, it's the Netherlands. I mean, it's Germany. It's Britain. Mm-hmm. In terms of models, you know, we have a terrible model. But in the Netherlands, if there's a addicted person on the street and they like set up a tent or something, everybody knows whose job it is to go and talk to that person and get them into shelter and get them the treatment and a personalized plan or whatever they need to get their life back together. Mm-hmm. Nobody knows what that is.
Is it the government?
So what we've done in the United States is that instead of actually having a proper agency in charge of it, it's been subcontracted to unqualified people in unqualified nonprofits whose responsibilities have not been clearly laid out. that are often overlapping with other people. And the consequence is that California spends more than almost every other state in the United States and has worse outcomes.
So I just want to stop on that, because to me, that was one of the most profound and important points in your thread. I noticed you said that. And as someone who's worked in government and on government policy, I thought this is like really important. So the for example, in San Francisco, there's this organization everyone talks about, GLIDE. Isn't it GLIDE, the church that does a lot of this? Right. And it's this kind of, you know, much, you know, praise like GLIDE. They do amazing work, you know, these wonderful people. And so you're saying that that's the sort of model, which is that the government puts money into it, state or local, and then gives it to nonprofits who then have well-intentioned, heroic people often. You know, like, I'm not questioning their, I'm sure you're not either, their decency and compassion and so on, but they're just going in there with the wrong mindset and the wrong philosophy. Is that a good summary of what's going on?
Yeah. And I mean, to some extent, you're right. I mean, there's obviously some good people and there's some not so great people in those organizations. But the broader point is that, there's some people that are activists and that have been using their service provision as a way to advance an agenda that is completely inappropriate and has made the problem worse. So, and I document that in the book.
What kind of agenda?
Well, I'll give you an example. The head of drug overdoses in San Francisco, the person who's supposedly in charge of reversing drug overdoses, has repeatedly said that we're not going to be able to reverse drug overdoses until we solve the problem of racism.
Right.
Like, that's not okay. Like, first of all, that same person, I suspect, when you really asked her, would probably admit that we're not getting rid of racism anytime soon. And honestly, a lot of forms of racism, maybe structural racism too, has declined as the problem has gotten worse.
Yeah.
But it's irresponsible. There is no plan to reverse the epidemic of overdoses in California or nationally right now. I mean, it's a shocking statement, but there is no plan. And I do hold some of the people involved in service provision with the failure of that plan, because they keep insisting on carrots only. All they want to do is revive people after they overdose with Narcan, as opposed to saying, as soon as you're Narcan'd, hey, you know, we saved your life. You need to go into drug treatment and it's mandatory. And you need to get psychiatric care and it's mandatory. And they insist that we not make it mandatory. And that's why we have 110,000 people on the street.
So would it be true to say that, I mean, again, just set me right on the proportions, that, you know, I'm just interested at the granular level, right? The individual person, the worker, social worker is the term used, who literally goes up physically to the person and interacts with them and deals with them and whatever. Are most of those people nonprofit workers who are paid by government money rather than public employees? Is that right?
Yeah, mostly. There's some public employees too, but mostly it's nonprofits. And they don't have the power to require that people go to shelter. They don't have the power to require that people get drug treatment or psychiatric care. Mm-hmm. Those decisions, they've been deprived of those powers. And they also don't have the proper institutions in which people should be placed. And so that's why we're in this.
This is really interesting. So when you say deprived of power, was there a time when they did have that power?
Oh, absolutely. And remember,
tell us about that.
So the brief history of mental illness is that it's been a very difficult problem to deal with, obviously, for much of human history. I mean, the ways that we often treated the mentally ill was to lock them in basements, chain them up in dungeons, chain them up in barns. In the 19th century, in both Europe and the United States, there was a very humanistic movement to create psychiatric hospitals that the mentally ill would be treated in. Over time, we stopped funding them properly. We also had a depression in the 30s, and then we had World War II, where they were grossly understaffed. And in that period, well-intentioned activists took photographs and wrote incredible journalism in the 40s, documenting the abuses in psychiatric hospitals. There's a famous, you know, book and movie, The Snake Pit, but there's also One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest is the most famous, with Jack Nicholson. And so America said, we don't want to do these big mental hospitals anymore. And there was some good arguments for different ways to care for the mentally ill at the community level. But we didn't do that. ACLU and others basically sued to just empty the hospitals and not allow for the psychiatric treatment of plainly, seriously mentally ill people in a defense of their liberty. And mm-hmm. so it's a left libertarian ideology mm-hmm. that says that it's better for people to be homeless and overdosing on the streets or to be in jail or prison, frankly, mm-hmm. than it is for them to be treated in the way that they are treated in every other country in the world, every other developed country in the world, I should say.
Right. So let's go back to that's really interesting. It actually does parallel a lot of the, you know, the story of that I kind of picked up when I was working on some of this in the UK. We've got the people that from the nonprofit, they're funded by the state, lots of money going into it. And now about to be, I mean, I think it's, they're talking about doubling it, isn't it? Because it's the numbers you mentioned 12 billion in the latest budget. I think I saw that the current budget is 13 billion or something like that. They like,
doubling. Yeah, it is.
It's unbelievable. They just are doubling the money. But you're saying that they're, I mean, what's that money going towards? It's being spent, it's being handed to these nonprofits who then do what? They go out and they don't actually do what you want to see, which is actually require people to change their behavior in exchange for a pathway to the kind of what they want to end up with, which is, as we all do, you know, a home, a job, all the rest of it. And so because they're not aware of that, because they're not able to, because they're not functioning in your term, then they can't do that without some kind of structure and incentive and carrot and stick. Have I got that right?
Yeah, you have it right. I mean, what we need is a whole new institution that mm-hmm. takes over this problem from the failed nonprofits and the failed counties that have made the problem worse mm-hmm. rather than fixing it. So I'm going to give it a name just because I think it's helpful to have a thing totally we're talking about.
Yeah.
Cal Psych. Call it Cal Psych.
Right.
It does several things. When somebody overdoses and is revived from Narcan, a Cal Psych van pulls up and says, "Hey, we need to get you into treatment now. We have a 90-day program for you. Mm-hmm. It's not here in the drug scene. You know, it's in the countryside or it's somewhere where land is cheaper. Absolutely. And you're here for 90 days. You're going to get a psychiatric evaluation. You know, if you agree to do this, you're free. You know, obviously, you're free to go. But if you don't do this, then we are going to call the police because you're completely out of control, and we're not going to just keep reviving you from mm-hmm. fentanyl mm-hmm. overdose." Mm-hmm. It would also then work with law enforcement so that when people are arrested for various things that are clearly caused by their addiction or their mental illness or both. Mm-hmm. That they then are working with law enforcement and the court system to make sure that people are following their plan. Mm-hmm. So Cal Psych would be staffed by competent social workers who are trained social workers who mm-hmm. are, it's mm-hmm. they use what's called assertive case management and a whatever it takes attitude mm-hmm. because you're mm-hmm. dealing with the most difficult people in the world, mm-hmm. mentally ill people, drug addicted people. These are people, these are the most difficult people in the world. Okay. Mm-hmm. To deal with. And they always mm-hmm. have been and always will be. So you need professionals dealing with them.
Yeah.
That same this agency, Cal Psych, would then also have the resources to purchase the back end things
right.
that people need.
The provision.
You got it. It'd be everything.
The treatment provision, jumping in.
Because you're right.
You talk about
right. You're right. Because the part of the problem with the propaganda word of homeless is that you're aggregating a really diverse population in some ways. So, you know, look, I mean, I interact with homeless a lot near my office. And so the 20-year-old kid mm-hmm. that is addicted to some combination of meth and heroin or fentanyl, and he's a middle-class kid who got kicked out of his parents' house because of his addiction, he needs something different than the guy with schizophrenia who is having an argument with an invisible person across the street. They need something different. Mm. One of them needs psychiatric care. He needs urgent psychiatric care. The other kid, you know, he needs some guy to, or some gal, somebody to put some mm-hmm. pressure on him and get him on the straight and narrow and probably a 90-day drug treatment program. But then towards the end of that, there's a plan to make sure that he is in Naranon to stay clean, that he has a job, and that he's reaffiliating, that's the technical word, reaffiliating with friends and family so that they can make a public commitment and he can get clean. And when that, if that kid relapses, and a lot of them do, it's a big part of recovery, he's got the same social worker. He's got the same plan. Right. He's got the same network. And there's one person, one empowered caseworker with a full, you know, digital
caseworking to handle it. It's so interesting to hear you talk about that, because funnily enough, I wrote this book, More Human, a few years ago. And as I was putting it together and writing it, and it's sort of a combination of looking back on some of the issues that I worked on when I was in the government, and then, you know, looking ahead to what the solution would be, I found myself over and over again on whatever problem it was, whether that's kind of dysfunctional families or whatever, you know, like I kept coming back to the kind of a sort of focal point, which is a human connection between someone suffering problems and someone competent and qualified, one person, not like a mass of different bureaucracies, one person who would be their, you know, coach, mentor, whatever you want to call it, like their case. And it's so true that the way we've set things up, but with all these different bureaucracies and organizations and lots of money thrown at it, you don't get that. And it's so interesting that you point to that here. So then what I think that's a really a couple of questions on that, like CalPsych. What are the barriers to that? What about the argument that you're taking away responsibility from local government where responsibility should lie? What about the civil liberties arguments? You can't force people to do things against their will. These are the things you hear.
Well, let's take the first issue, which is that where does the responsibility for handling homeless addiction, mental illness, where should it lie? The idea has been that it should lie in the counties. That's in our constitution.
Right.
Obviously, it's failed. We've covered that. It's obviously failed. Is that because everybody in all these different counties is incompetent? Look, there's some amount of that. And like I said, I'm not going to let people that shouldn't be let off the hook because the institutions are broken. But the institutions are broken. And part of the problem here is you have to remember this is an incredibly transient population. Mm-hmm. That's why homeless used to be called transients. And even hobo had that connotation. So we know when you survey people on the streets, and in San Francisco, but it's basically the same in other California cities, at least 30% were homeless before coming to San Francisco. Some of the people I talk to say it's really closer to 50%. When you go around Los Angeles and you interview folks in Venice Beach or wherever, at least 30 to 50% will say they were made homeless before they came there. So they're an incredibly transient population. They're often shopping around. There's mythologies. One of the mythologies that the homeless are somehow sedentary. They're incredibly mobile. You know, they move all over the place, and often they're escaping the law. Or escaping other people. You know, it is a technical word, although I think it's a really accurate one. And I use it in the book, which is just disaffiliation. These are disaffiliated people.
Yeah, that makes sense.
They're disaffiliated from family and friends because of their addiction or untreated mental illness or both. And so part of the reason you have to have CalPsych is you have to have one person that is really responsible for making sure that this person follows their plan and obeys the law, whether they're in L.A., Sacramento, Eureka, San Francisco, Berkeley, wherever.
Yeah.
Obviously, if they leave the state, then it has to somehow transfer to other states. But in most states, it's already centralized. It's not divided up by county in Colorado. I mean, Colorado might have county involvement, but there is a kind of state engagement by most other states. So I think states is the right level at which this service should be operated. There is some people are mobile outside of states, but a lot of the transients in California is within the state.
That's a really interesting point.
Yeah.
So right now, I mean, this $12 billion that we're going to get from the state budget, is that going to be just handed out to counties? Is that kind of what we can expect from that?
Yeah, the governor has refused to hold the counties responsible for anything, including adding more housing, dealing with their homeless populations. He kind of rolls into town sometimes and says things like, oh, we got to clean it up more around here. Mm-hmm. But he doesn't do anything to hold counties responsible. And that's for political reasons. He wants to be president of the United States. He wants to be liked. He wants to be popular. So he's what the Dutch call a soft doctor. You know, the Dutch
I like that.
The Dutch say, so they have Dutch have an expression which is soft doctors make wounds stink. And I was like, you mean because they don't clean the infection properly? And they were like, yeah. So like, because they're too soft. So yeah, Gavin hasn't been able to hold any of the counties responsible for this. He refuses to do so. So not only is the $12 billion going to be wasted, it's going to make the problem worse.
Because you're going to have things like, so the one thing I've specifically seen him say is that Project Roomkey is a model for the rest of the country.
I mean, terrifying. I mean,
we haven't mentioned Project Roomkey yet. For those who don't know what it is, can you just explain what it is and then tell us why it's terrifying?
Well, I mean, it starts as with a good premise, which is that they had to reduce the density in the homeless shelters to prevent the spread of COVID. And so they started, and then the hotels were failing, and the hotels needed to be bailed out no matter what, or they would have all gone bankrupt. Mm-hmm. So they started putting homeless people in hotel rooms. But the problem is that they were giving out the hotel rooms without requiring anything in return. Yeah. And so what happened is a lot of people went into those hotel rooms and died of drug overdoses. Because when you're using drugs with your friends and somebody overdoses, everybody has Narcan, which is, you know, the thing you suck up the nose and it revives you from your overdose. The people die in their hotel rooms alone. And not only that, but the addictions got worse because, you know, during the pandemic, there was even less law enforcement, less consequence. I mean, at least when you're a hardcore addict, one of the stories that you hear a lot is that you would get, you know, you get taken into jail every once in a while and you go into jail and you detox. It might help you out with, you know, Suboxone, which is a way to make, it's like methadone. It makes the withdrawal pains less. Mm-hmm. But then you have some time where you actually are clean. You have some time where you're not doing meth and fentanyl every day, multiple times a day, mm-hmm. and your body can rest and you can recover. These guys didn't have that during the pandemic. And Project Roomkey is housing first housing. It's housing without any obligations. And so the idea that you're going to go do more of that, it's going to result in more death. It's going to result in more people dying.
Yeah. So you think it should be the state level. That makes sense. The second objection I hear a lot, and I just anecdotally, this is what comes up a lot where when people talk about it in California, and this has been going on for years, which is, it's this sort of crazy liberal kind of civil liberties thing, which means that the authorities would like to forcibly require people to go through treatment or go to a shelter, but they can't because they have rights to live on the streets and et cetera. What's the role of that aspect?
Yeah, I mean, look, I mean, we all of us treasure our freedom. I treasure I've been to some very oppressive authoritarian governments in the world. And believe me, I would be adamantly opposed and would fight to the death to keep sane people out of psychiatric institutions. And I'm called crazy myself. So for people, you know, any use of the state to incarcerate or involuntarily hospitalize people would be absolutely outrageous, and we should be against it. And in fact, people with severe mental illness like schizophrenia also don't want to be in hospitals for their whole lives. And the Dutch have succeeded there too, helping people with schizophrenia have their own apartments, have their own jobs. Mm-hmm. It's really hard to have schizophrenia and live a life, but they've managed to do it. It's really humane. So we don't want to do that. You know, at the same time, when you have no mandatory treatment at all, people get worse and they die. And so there's a lot of room between letting people with schizophrenia die on the street and locking people up in hospitals for the rest of their lives. Okay, that's the first thing you have to understand. Yeah. In the book, I have a conversation with the head of the person of the ACLU, who is the most influential person on this in California. And I'm like, okay, what about people with dementia? We don't let people with dementia live on the street. Grandma, when she has dementia, she has to go to the nursing home. So why is it different for people with psychosis? And her answer to me was basically that people with mental illness are both too mentally ill to be arrested for crimes they commit, but not so mentally ill like people with dementia to be involuntarily hospitalized. So it's absurd.
But what about the on both of them, actually, And I think this is going to be the sort of last point I think that we need to get into, because I think that you've sold your model, to, certainly to me, very persuasively. I think that makes total sense, what you've described, both the state-level institution and the way that it would operate and the services that we provided, carrot plus stick, all of that, totally convinced. But in terms of the barriers, there's what about the for both the state-level action, but also the kind of involuntary aspect, are there actual constitutional or legal barriers that even if, let's say, you had a governor elected who 100% signed up to what you're proposing, they couldn't do it either because of the state constitution or the US constitution in terms, I mean, is there, do we need something more than just a politician who proposes this as a solution? Does there need to be amendments to the state constitution literally to make this happen?
We don't. We actually have two really good laws already, a conservatorship law, which is referred to as guardianship in most other states and countries, mm-hmm. and also something called assisted outpatient treatment for people with severe mental illness that won't take their medicines and mm-hmm. potentially pose a threat to themselves or others. Those are constitutional. They exist. Nobody's challenging their constitutionality. It's purely political. Oh, we simply need to use those tools more. The only reason we're not is because ACLU and the coalition of groups that it's supported over the years put so much pressure on Democratic politicians that they haven't been able to use conservatorship and assisted outpatient treatment in the ways that they want to. And recall, nobody's proposing to hospitalize people because they have mental illness. We're only talking about people that break the laws. We're only talking about people that are breaking the law already and are potentially arrested for it. Nobody's proposing. And the same thing goes, if you want to smoke fentanyl in the privacy of your own home, I think you're bananas, but right. I don't think that we should spend any taxpayer money arresting you. And I don't think other Californians think that either.
Yes. Last quick point. Those two laws, California laws on the books.
Most states have a conservatorship law or a guardianship law like we have, and that's what passed in 1972 as part of the Lantrum and Petras Act that Reagan signed and ACLU basically wrote, conservatorship. Mm-hmm. That's much more strict, conservatorship. The softer version is assisted outpatient treatment, and that also is passed into law. It's called Laura's Law, and it was passed because of this phenomenon that we have around the world, really, of people that are not taking psychiatric medicines. Yeah. Hurting people, killing people. It killed this young woman,
that's
Laura.
Also a California law.
But that is a California law, correct?
Fantastic. Great. Okay. Last question. I mean, honestly, we talked for so long, but I'm sort of trying the patience. So we try and sort of keep it to a reasonable length. And I hope we'll talk many, many more times, Mike, because I love your approach to all of this. And there's many other issues. Just last question on this. Do you see any sign of any, I'm going to say Democrat politician in California, because of the, you know, reality of the political, composition of the state. I mean, you know, one day maybe that can change. That's one of the things that we're fighting for on the show, is that kind of political change. But is there any sign that your approach is making any headway with anyone politically?
Well, one of the most interesting things I discovered in my research, and he's a character in the book, and also he's one of the characters that's in the tweets and the articles that I just did on it, is a guy named Tom Insel, Dr. Thomas Insel. He is the governor's main advisor on mental illness. He was the head of the National Institute of Mental Health from 2003 to 2000. Okay, I'm not sure the exact years, but for like 15 years, he was the head of it. Widely respected psychiatrist. He and I had a lovely Zoom interview, and we agreed on everything, like literally everything, including Cal Psych. And so I was kind of like, okay, so can't you talk to the governor about this? And he was very careful, you know, because he's a political person, too.
Yeah.
But he just kept, when I went back over my notes, I discovered that he basically had said like five or six times, it's a leadership problem. It's a leadership problem. Yeah. It's a leadership problem. It's a leadership problem. So, you know, we have a governor who is a weak leader created by good times. You know, good times create weak leaders who are not willing to stand up to various interest groups and tell them they need to sit down.
That's a very deep point, by the way.
Thank you. By the way, it's, none of these points are mine. I'm just stealing ideas from other people and trying to combine them.
Well, that's, you know, good times make weak leaders. I mean, so interesting. Okay. So that
you know what bad times make people.
What?
Bad times make strong leaders.
Yeah. So, and they're not always great either. It depends what you do with strength. So that's just really unbelievably informative. And I think it's a great, it's an example of one of my favorite things, which is someone who gives intellectual backup to my prejudices. So I thought all this stuff, and you've really crystallized it and given us so much detail. And what I think you've done is such a great job of kind of putting it into some sense of structure, that it's something that really, you know, people can kind of take that forward. I hope they do. I just think it makes so much sense. Feels like the issue is being so, it's just becoming more and more unacceptable to people. So I don't know. I feel like there is hope here, but there's certainly hope in the sense that there's an actual solution that is not outlandish or inconceivable that we could actually make. And certainly the money's there because they're spending tons of money on it. Right, let's leave it there for now. As I say, I'm dying to talk to you again about all sorts of, about this, your book, climate, nuclear power, so many things you've got such interesting perspectives on. But for now, Michael, thank you so much. It's been a great pleasure.
Thanks, Steve. Thanks for having me on.
And thank you for being with us, and come back soon for the next California Rebel Base.